Ki ngā kaiwhitiki ngā mātāpono te tiriti o Waitangi, tēnā koutou katoa. I'm Shane Taurima and you're watching Marae, the Great Waitangi Debate. For some, it's a living document that defines us as a nation. For others, it's a relic of our colonial past that's best forgotten. And then there are those who simply don't know or don't want to know about the Treaty of Waitangi. That's a far cry from its original vision of he iwi tahi tātou, of being one people. It may have something to do with the impression that it's an obstacle to progress, that somehow this 170-year-old treaty gets in our way and stops us from moving forward. Is there any truth to that? Today, Marae debates the motion, is the Treaty of Waitangi holding New Zealand back? To help us are our panel guests, who all have different opinions. Speaking for the motion that the treaty is holding New Zealand back is Stephen Franks, a lawyer specialising in commercial law and constitutional issues. Stephen is also a former MP and Māori Affairs spokesperson for the ACT Party. And with him is Tim Wikiriwhi, a member of the Libertarians, a political party that supports a free society and a free market economy. Tim was their Māori Affairs spokesperson for 10 years. Against the motion that the treaty is not holding New Zealand back is Hana O'Regan, a Māori language commissioner with Te Tauira Whiri I Te Reo Māori. Hana was also on the government ministerial panel, which last year reviewed the foreshore and seabed legislation. And with her is Matthew Hooton, a political commentator and managing director of communications company Exceltium. Matthew was a speechwriter and press secretary in the New Zealand government in the 1990s. Ladies and gentlemen, please extend a warm welcome to our panel. And of course, a big welcome to our studio audience. It's a pleasure to have you with us. Our studio audience aren't here to simply make up the numbers. Over the next hour, each panellist will step up to the Marae lectern and present their argument for or against the motion. Each panellist will have 2 minutes to speak uninterrupted. After that, I'll interview each one individually, and then we'll take questions and comments from our audience.
People say that the treaty is holding New Zealand back. What's your thoughts?
I don't think it's holding New Zealand back.
I think it is. Yeah, I think it is.
It's a bit of a celebration of something that's good.
I don't know what that means.
Rather than often, you know, people tend to think of all the stinking negative things.
What do you mean by holding New Zealand back?
Like keeping us in the past or like...
Yeah.
It's that one thing that everyone's holding on to, that everyone tends to find it a way to disagree with.
The treaty is our constitution, so if you're not going to come up with a brand new constitution, then the treaty is it.
If everyone just forgot about everything and moved on, we are what we are, just leave it, yeah.
Everyone should forget the past and just move on, eh?
Sweet,
eh? You reckon?
I'm now going to invite our first panellist, Stephen Franks, to speak for the motion that the Treaty of Waitangi is holding New Zealand back. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Stephen Franks to the lectern.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, thanks for being here, and I am thankful. This is the first time I can remember this question being asked so bluntly on Television One, and I think that's part of what has been holding us back. There have been a whole lot of areas of normal political discussion that have been off limits, and it's not the treaty, the real treaty, that was signed 170 years ago, at the end of which Governor Hobson said, "Hei iwi tahi tātou," we are now we are one. It's a treaty that's been invented in the 80s by academics and politicians and lawyers to whom it's given a permanent right to stick their oar in and to prescribe and to get preference and to get money when otherwise they wouldn't have been able to persuade people to do it. The real treaty has produced a great process in the settlements for breaches of property rights. That's what it promised. Two very simple things, classical English property rights and equality as British citizens under the law. And it was a huge thing at that time between parties who were so clearly unequal in all sorts of dimensions. The fake treaty has invented so-called principles, which mean whatever people want at the time, and a spurious partnership. And the consequence is serious, because it means we keep compromising our standards. We have non-merit appointments, tokens. We have things like demands for the Auckland City Council seats. We have separate programs in prisons and sentencing. We have health preferences. Things that don't have to prove that they work. They're justified on the grounds of this this 1980s invention. So the real respect, if the treaty was the real treaty was being respected, it would help us. But I would suggest that the treaty that we are working under at the moment is the one that was invented. It isn't forward looking, and is a millstone. The real treaty would be, as Hobson said, a recipe for us being one people. He iwi tahi tato.
Let me ask you, Stephen Franks, are you scared of the treaty?
Well, certainly not of the real treaty. I would like to see it used.
You talk about the real treaty. What do you mean?
I mean the document that was signed in Maori and in English that said the Crown is sovereign, that property rights will be protected, and that we are all British subjects under the law.
But we've moved on. 170 years later, you can't expect us to stay back there.
Well, I can't see what's wrong with any of those. If as people claim it's our constitutional founding document, it's not bad. I mean, it's a fragment. It doesn't deal with most of the issues that you'd have in a constitution. But as it stands, it was good. But because it didn't go far enough, those who wanted to use it to justify racial discrimination invented stuff. Now, that's the stuff that's holding us back.
So what's been invented? You talk about racial discrimination. Yeah. Give me one example.
A really simple one, and I used it, was the mention of the claim to that it was undemocratic and wrong and a breach of the treaty not to have reserved seats on the Auckland City Council.
What's so wrong with reserved seats?
Well, simply that it's not based either on a democratic principle or on merit. It's not based on what's in the best interests of New Zealand. It's a grab for power by a very tiny group claiming to represent a whole lot of people on the basis of a characteristic few of us actually have. I mean, it's 30 years ago, Peter Tapsell and Matt Rata changed our electoral law so that you're Maori if you feel like it, unlike most of the world, Canada, for example, because they could see that there would be no Maori seats left if you had to be more Maori than Pākehā. We didn't have a justification for what was recreated in the 80s.
You talk about preferential treatment. You talk about separate programs for Māori. Māori would deem a lot of those programs as Māori-initiated programs, like Kohanga Reo Kura Kaupapa. What's wrong with those sort of initiatives?
They are superb, but they don't need the
but
treaty.
But they work and others don't?
Yeah, but they're not treaty-based. That is because it is very sensible to give people the freedom to take programs in the way that works best. I'm not against different treatment for different people. I'm against the state making it a claim when it's not justified by anything other than colour. Or in fact, not even colour now, by racial inheritance.
A lot of Māori, they will disagree. Kohanga Reo Kura Kaupapa, there are other initiatives out there too, like rehabilitation, justice, programs that have been initiated by Māori and that actually work.
Well, I don't disagree. I think they're
fantastic. But these are programs that have been created under the treaty.
No, they're not. They're programs which any sensible government would do. You would tailor your programs to suit what works best. But many of them have been immune from
question.
Well,
give me one that's not working.
Well, I'll give you an example.
One that's not working.
Okay, it's the area I know well, that quite a lot of the, I won't call them Māori immersion, the Māori focus units in prison systems and in corrections generally were not subject to proper examination for their effectiveness, and when they were finally measured, it became clear that those that seemed to be working were working because there were some inspirational people running them. The same programs elsewhere failed completely. So just as everywhere, it's the individuals and their characteristics that matter, not the colour of their skin or their racial inheritance.
Well, let's throw it open to the audience. Veronica Tarfai, what do you think?